fly over Mars, take a trek through a prehistoric jungle, tour a house that has not yet been built. It's called virtual reality, and as Jay Schaefer found out, all it takes is a special helmet and a glove, and you're off.
You're gone, John. You're history.
It's a computer-generated world where you see and move and feel. Will real life ever be the same?
From ABC News, with anchors Diane Sawyer in New York, Sam Donaldson in Washington, Chief Correspondent Chris Wallace, Judd Rose, Jay Shadler, and Sylvia Chase. This is Prime Time.
It was more than 100 years ago that Lewis Carroll wrote about Alice's trip through the looking glass. Now, that fiction has become a reality, or you might say a virtual reality, because that's the name of a new computer technology that many believe will revolutionize the way we live. As Jay Shadler explains, virtual reality lets you travel to places you've never been and see things you've never seen and do things you've never done without ever leaving the room.
If dreams could be sold, what would you buy? The poet's question may soon have a practical answer.
The goal of virtual reality is simple. It's total submersion, complete detachment from reality.
The doors are opening on a world where the line between reality and illusion has dissolved.
I want to fly over Mars. I want to experience everything the roving exploration machines experience. I want to be there. I want to explore the planets myself.
Advances in computer graphics over the past 10 years are making it possible to create artificial three-dimensional worlds, complete and convincing, though they only exist in the mind of the viewer and the heart of the computer. Known as virtual reality, or VR, this new technology uses pictures and sounds to wrap around your senses. Imagine a place and you'll be able to step into it. Conjure up a dream and you'll be able to fly through it.
It's unreal. It's different, and it's so natural that when you experience it, it's something that, people come out of the system and say, wow, that's unreal.
Jonathan Waldron is a 31-year-old computer scientist in England. As a college student, he designed computer graphics. Now, he's launched one of the first companies to mass-produce virtual reality systems.
Okay, so here we are going into virtual space, and here I want to show you a little application where we've got a car, engine.
As with most VR systems, Waldron's uses stereoscopic images projected onto tiny screens inside the viewer's helmet. A powerful computer then generates the graphics and sounds needed to convince the viewer he's in another world. The illusion is completed when motion sensors in Waldron's glove and helmet allow him to begin interacting with whatever he sees.
What I can do is, as you can see, freely move the articles all around anywhere I like in space. Now, on a conventional computer, this would take an awful long time. Here in the virtual world, you just pick them up and move them around.
The technology that created this hands-on control of an imaginary world is already being used to recreate distant worlds.
There is a cliff along the horizon here. That's one cliff of Valles Marineris. There's the canyon running in this direction east.
Michael McGreevy is a principal engineer at NASA Ames Research Center in California. Using virtual reality techniques, two-dimensional electronic pictures sent back from the Viking orbiters have been converted into a three-dimensional model of the planet Mars.
I would want to walk right around between these boulders.
NASA geologists and armchair astronauts are literally exploring the universe without ever leaving home.
You can extend your presence across the information domain. You can be any size, any place, at any time.
There are, of course, more down-to-earth applications of virtual reality. Detailed models of city landscapes are giving urban planners a chance to redesign Main Street without ever lifting a stone. And architects can show you around your new home even before the first brick is laid.
The hardest part of designing anything, including a building, is deciding what it is you want to design exactly.
Professor Frederick Brooks is one of the pioneers in virtual reality. His computer science center at the University of North Carolina was partially designed with VR technology. Instead of helmets and sensory gloves, a treadmill and handlebars steer the computer.
This kind of technology lets not only the architect, but more important, the client, walk together through the proposed new building and suddenly say, oh, this kitchen works fine for cooking, but it doesn't work for parties.
Seem far-fetched? Try far-flung. In Japan, virtual reality is already a consumer's choice. In this Tokyo showroom, a housewife thinking about redesigning her kitchen need only slip into VR gloves and goggles. But one of the most promising applications of virtual reality is in medicine. This cancer patient has a tumor. It has to be located and then bombarded with radiation beams. Current techniques for positioning those beams are painstakingly slow and potentially dangerous.
The whole technique of radiation therapy requires bringing very strong X-ray beams to bear on the tumor. The task is, how do you put the beams through so that they hit the tumor and miss other sensitive parts of the anatomy, such as the spinal cord or the eyes?
So Brooks and his colleagues have begun testing a VR system that takes traditional CAT scan images and turns them into a three-dimensional model of the patient's body. Doctors will be able to plan their method of attacking the tumor on this virtual patient, even before the real patient enters the hospital.
So for all intents and purposes, the physician could walk around this virtual body and kind of reach up into space and align these radiation beams to zap the tumor.
Yes, and he sees the tumor, and he sees the beams in their standard position, and he reaches out and takes one and aims it until it goes through the tumor. And he can look along it and see what it's hitting and what it's missing.
Clearly, virtual reality now straddles that foggy boundary between fantasy and fact. Just 9 years ago, a science fiction movie called Tron showed what it might be like not just to play a video game, but to become part of it. Well, Hollywood's dream is John Waldron's nightmare. At least that's what he calls this virtual world made for two. A video game where the players are on the inside looking out.
Now the boys are here.
I've got a joystick. I've got a helmet.
That's right. And you just put the helmet on like that.
Right.
And of course you see that you have a gun in your hand. And to fire the gun, you simply press the trigger. And I'll get in and join you.
Okay. Come into my world, John.
Linked by a computer that tracks our individual motions, Waldron and I are now both inside the same electronic world.
There you are.
Hi.
Hello there.
The game board consists of several checkerboard platforms floating in space. The goal, to chase and shoot your opponent.
I've got the gun in my hand here. I hate to do this to you right now, but I missed.
It lobs down. We've made gravity twice what it should be.
You're gone, John. You're history.
As the game proceeds, two prehistoric birds slip into view. If one picks you up by the scruff of your neck, the sense of flying can be all too realistic.
I'm a little worried about that flying pterodactyl at this point. Oh, here comes the bird. Where's that bird?
He's got you. He's got you again.
Ah, he got me from behind. Oh, my God. I think I have to take this helmet off. I'm physically feeling the spacer for a second. Oh, my God.
While I was playing the game, it seems virtual reality was playing a trick on my mind. The pictures and sounds around me were all that was necessary to convince me I was walking, flying, and falling.
The visual display at the moment is crude. There are these crude cartoon-like characters. That's not the issue. The fact of the matter is, in virtual reality, there is no limit to what we can do. We can be anywhere, anytime, any place, and it's really, that's the issue. It's total escapism.
Quite a game, or is it? Virtual reality had its roots in flight simulators, and today the military is a major user of the technology. American pilots plan their bombing runs on Iraq across a virtual sky, and tank commanders practiced on a virtual battlefield.
We are now reaching the point where the simulations are so realistic that the line between playing a game or a simulation and actually blowing people up is becoming blurred.
Howard Rheingold has just published the first book on virtual reality. And like all technology, this one, he says, comes complete with a double-edged sword.
There's no way of a soldier in a simulator knowing whether their commanding officer has thrown a switch somewhere and instead of playing a game, they're bombing real people.
For now, any flickering moral doubts about this technology remain hidden by its potential power and promise. Today, VR is still in its infancy. But as computers grow more powerful, the graphics more detailed, and the sensations more human, virtual reality will force us to ask, what is real? It will be up to our children to find the answer.
What kind of reality are our grandchildren going to accept? Is the natural world with real trees and real rivers going to be there? Or are we going to live in 800-story high-rises all plugged into our virtual realities in which we walk through artificial forests? This might be a turning point for the human race. We might be going inward towards an artificial experience.
In case you're wondering about the virtual price tag for one of these systems, right now they run from about $50,000 to $200,000. We leave you tonight with some more pictures from virtual reality, and we invite you to join us again next Thursday night for another edition of Primetime Live.
Primetime is a presentation of ABC News. More Americans get their news from ABC News than from any other source.